Alright, this is DDRKirby with another FL Studio tutorial. This is probably going to be part one of a two-part series. Modus over on the OC Remix forums requested that I talk about filling out your soundscape, and so I'm first going to talk about how I mix my songs in general, and basically how I use EQ. Nothing too fancy, and then in part two I'm going to talk a little bit more abstractly about fullness and how to construct, how I construct soundscapes and songs. Anyways, the song I have for you today is called Christmas Night. It's a song that was recently released as part of 9-Bit Blizzard, which is a chiptune compilation album by 9-Bit Records, which you should go check out. I'll have the link in the description. Here's a section that I'm going to play for you right now. Okay, so that's pretty cool. We've got a really full chorus here with pretty much all parts of the soundscape filled out. Just one note before I start getting into things. The version of the song right here is actually not exactly the same as the version on the album. I actually had to tune down the volume because my music's really loud, and because loud music is good, and yeah, so I had to tune it down to fit match the rest of the tracks in the album, because I like making my songs really loud and compressed a little bit more than other people do. Anyways, so first off, the percussion. Let's see. Yeah, this. So generally, I don't actually do any very minimal EQ on my percussion. There's actually is an EQ on my kick drum, but it's I'm not actually using it. Yeah, I don't think there's any EQ at all done on my drums here in this song, and that's generally the case for all the songs I make. The one exception that I sometimes make is, oh, I guess I did do it here. Sometimes I'll roll off the low end of my snare sometimes. And that's just because to get a little bit more breathing room in the mid-low range, because that snare hit, I don't really, so if I take the EQ off, it's got a little bit more low end, barely noticeable, but it gives you a little bit more breathing room sometimes. The other thing I might recommend is sometimes on my hi-hats, or on your hi-hats, you can boost the high end a little bit if you want some extra like tinkle, some extra sizzle, some extra treble. So you can play around with that if you'd like. I'm gonna take that off for now though. So generally I don't really EQ my drums. I don't really... Okay, so first of all, my approach to mixing is pretty much to keep everything very simple. I don't use very fancy tools. I just use plain old EQ. I do have a mastering suite in Isotope Ozone 5, but I kind of use the same settings for every song. I just have the maximizer, a little bit of harmonic excitation, and a little bit of global reverb. Really nothing fancy. Yeah, I try to keep things very simple, and you'll see that when I go through the EQ for each instrument. So let's start at the bottom, which is the bass. If I can get to play. Here. Nope. Here we go. Okay, so that's pretty boring. This is just a simple Famitracker triangle wave. Again, it's using a custom waveform, that's why it's got the aliased sound. And for basses, I usually don't do much EQing. Sometimes I'll roll off the high end, sometimes I'll do a really aggressive roll off like this. It really depends on how much of that, how many of those like higher harmonics you want. If it's in an isolated section and you want to make sure that, for example, your bass can still be audible on headphones, then I'll leave a little bit more of it in. If it's just a something I purely want as a sub bass, then I'll just cut all of it out. So right now I have it kind of as middle ground here. Moving on, we've got a mid-range bass, which is here, I believe. No, not there. Here. And you see here that I've rolled off the very low end because I don't want it conflicting with my sub bass. And I've rolled out the very high end because I don't want it conflicting with all my treble melody instruments. So it's mainly concentrated in the mid-low range. This is where this bass is supposed to be. If I take out the EQ, you notice it has a lot more high end, a lot more buzz. I don't actually need any of that to sit in the mix. One other thing I forgot to mention about the bass, the main bass, is that I have it side-chained. So I've got a side-chaining channel here. So you can hear it kind of duck away for an instant there. If I put the kick back in, and so that's pretty subtle in, for this particular song, but still, it's another chance to give yourself a little bit more breathing room. And if you're wondering how I did that side chaining, I have a dummy kick in this channel that's called Side Chainer, and I just have that routed to the fruity limiter, which I use for side chaining. Okay, moving on. We've got pads. There's actually two separate pads in this section. One is a gated pad. It sounds like this. That's pretty cool. We've also got this sustain pad that sounds like this. And for both of these pads, I want to definitely take out all of the mid-low range because I want a very thin treble sound. I'm also going to roll off the very extreme high end because I don't want it to conflict with my melody instruments. So if I take out the EQ, you'll notice that it sounds much fuller. And you know, that sound is okay in isolation. If, for example, the pads were the only thing playing. But since I've got all this other stuff going on, I really only want this mid-high treble range here. So I'm really making the sound a lot more thin. And same thing with the gated pad. I've got my EQ for that right here. Same sort of thing. Just roll off the bottom, roll off the top. Okay, moving on, we've got a see this arpeggio sequence here, or I guess I should go to the main melody first. You'll see here that I've rolled off the low end here because this is a treble instrument. I don't want the bass in. I haven't rolled it off completely because if I did that, it would sound a bit too thin. That's cutting off a bit too much of the fundamental frequency there. So I rolling it off, you know, kind of taking a middle ground here. And then I boost the high treble end. And this is important because it really helps your lead instruments speak and cut through the mix. So without that, let's see how that sounds a lot more dull, a lot more dull, and a lot less bright. And so if I do this, it'll cut through the mix a lot better. You'll also notice that since I have harmony here, I'm actually using two different channels for that, and one is panned to the right and one is panned to the left. So if I take out that panning, it sounds like this, all in the center. But just to separate that out a little bit so that the notes are a little bit more distinct, I pan them to opposite sides. And it's pretty subtle. I don't want a drastic effect. Like, if I wanted a drastic effect, maybe I'd pan them 50%. But I didn't really want that. I just wanted to kind of separate them out in the sound field a little bit, just so that they're not clashing too much with each other, so that you can still hear the harmonies, both notes. And lastly, we've got a high arpeggio going on here. And my idea with this is that I wanted something that sits on top of the lead instrument that we heard before. And so for that, I made sure I rolled off a lot of the middle range. I rolled off a lot, pretty much everything except for the high treble end. So without EQ, the bass sound sounds like this. So it's got a lot more low end. So if I roll all that off, you get a much thinner sound. And you'll notice again that I've boosted the high treble here. You might be wondering why I have this here rolling off the extreme high end. I don't always do this. I believe in this case it's because I noticed that there was a bit of buzziness in the extreme highs, and so I wanted to take that out. I think that I really do that on a case-by-case basis. If my sound is just a little bit too buzzy, it's actually sometimes hard to tell, because I think sometimes FL's 3 oscillator synth is more buzzy in preview mode than in render mode, because it has a little bit of aliasing, so sometimes I have a hard time making a call on that, but that's what I happen to do for this song. The main idea here is I wanted it, again, to not be in the same frequency range as my main lead instruments, but on top of it. So if I play those two together, you know, that sort of blends pretty nicely. And this is also, you know, a lot of this is not just the EQ, but also the arrangement. So like, if I had these two main melody synths an octave up, for example, I don't actually know what this sounds like, but it probably sounds a lot worse. So especially in these two measures, the arpeggio becomes a lot less clear. And kind of just blends in with the other two instruments, especially because they're using similar waveforms. So if I put them back, you'll notice that it's much clearer. And so the idea here is that you really want to, when you're having a really full chorus section like this, you really want to plan out your entire soundscape. So if, you know, we've got the low bass on bottom, and adding in the mid-low bass, that's here. You've got your pads above that. And sitting on top of that, we've got the melody. And then finally on top of that, we have this high arpeggio. And of course, added the drums. Just to show you how much of a difference all this EQing made, I'm going to go and try to switch off all the EQ on all this stuff that we just did. Okay, so now let's hear how the thing sounds with basically no EQ. So that sounds pretty, I don't want to say crappy because it's still a good song, but sounds a lot more muddy. You can notice that in the mid-low range, there's just a lot of like mud there, and like this mid-low range here is where things really get muddy. So you really want to be careful about that. That's why especially for the pads, it's really important in full sections like these that you really cut off this part right here. Because that's going to free up room for your mid bass and your sub bass. So I'm not saying that you have to lay out, if you're making a chorus, you have to lay out all your instruments exactly like this. You don't have to have a sub bass and a mid bass, and you know, you could have just one really fat bass, and you don't have to have a high arpeggio on top of your lead. I mean, it can all be different, but the point of all this is that as you're thinking about what instruments to put in, really in the arrangement phase, you want to make sure that you don't pick sounds that are just going to mask each other and conflict with each other. And here everything functions as a whole because I've layered everything on top of each other, you know, bottom, middle bottom, mid high, and then highest. And of course it sounds really bad now because I disabled all the EQ. Let's quickly try and turn that all back on. Okay, one other thing that I'm going to talk about in this particular song is when we have the chorus again. Oh, you'll notice that the high arpeggio has been replaced by a more prominent version of that. And again, the same thing here. Even though I didn't thin out the sound as much as the previous arpeggio, notice how this peak here is higher than, if I can find it. It's higher. Okay, well, I guess I didn't make it that much higher. But ideally, it would be, in my mind, it would be higher than the peak for the main melody, because I want this higher arpeggio sound to be centered at a higher frequency. That way, they don't bleed into each other as much. One other thing you can think about as you're building this is that frequency is not the only way to separate your instruments out. Really, the goal of mixing is to try and make sure that no two instruments occupy the same sonic space, because if they do, then they're going to be really hard to distinguish. So I already explained to you that the main melody instruments are panned left and right. Another thing you can do with panning is not pan things to left and right, but increase the width of the instrument. And so, for example, this arpeggio sequence here, I chose to make it a very wide, give it a lot of stereo separation by using this phase randomness knob. So if I turn that all the way down, so you see that's a much more centered sound as opposed to this. It's especially apparent if you're listening on headphones. And so I did that partially because I wanted the lead instruments to be more front and center, but also just because I wanted it to be doing something different in terms of the stereo field than the lead instruments do, because that helps set it apart a little bit more. If I had all of the instruments in this track in, you know, smack dead center, the mix just wouldn't sound as good. One last thing is you'll notice that at this section, when the melody kind of fades out, uh, I don't know if you could catch it, but the arpeggio actually gets louder at that point, and that's due to this automation right here, I believe. So if you listen just to the arpeggio, seems like there's a bit of phasing there, that's not good. But it's only a little bit, it's using this EQ2, and it's only, let's say, 2 decibels louder at that point. But the reason I did that is because I wanted the lead, so I wanted the main, so during this first section, that arpeggio is not really the focus. Yes, it built up in the previous measures. But once we get to the chorus, it's no longer the focus. It's no longer the main thing that the listener needs to hear. That's the melody. And so the melody needs to be the focal point. That's why I actually have this automation. So it starts at full volume, and then here it gets 2 decibels softer. Let's hear that. It's a bit hard to hear the difference, but I consciously made that decision so that the main melody would stand out a little bit more, and so that we wouldn't have too crowded of space here. And then once the main melody, once we get to this the second phrase, I guess, of the chorus, now the main melody is gone, so the arpeggio is the main focus, and so that's why I brought the volume of that out a little bit. And in general, I don't actually like to do too much of this volume automation, because I think it makes mixing more complex, and the more of these things you have, the harder it is to put together the mix in the end. It just feels like you're working with too many variables, but it can really be... These things can be a useful tool if you just think about what you're trying to accomplish with your song. And I believe I've talked way too much for this part of the tutorial, so I'm going to leave it at that. Hopefully you enjoyed this, and let me know if you have any questions.